My name is FitterSpace. I'm sort of the pioneer of this category. I'm mostly kind of an old school Nightfire runner, but nowadays I just kind of do like task stuff here and there.
Matimbre.
Hello everyone, I'm Matimbre. I've been running this game for about 6 years now, and I am the former world record holder of this game.
And Exile Prince.
Hey guys, I'm Exile Prince. I'm kind of like the noob with among these guys. Started like a little bit later and yet to get a sub 40 for like 80%, but you know, I'm still here for that competitive spirit, still love the game. And it was my first ever like game I decided to pick up on speedrunning.
Cool, okay. So as the name implies, this category is called All Tokens. Now, this is going to start by, well, Fetter, do you want to explain the category, how this works and what I'm going to do here?
Sure. The idea is that All Tokens takes place sort of on a second playthrough of the game. The first time you play through the game, let's say you get all the gold medals. The second time you play through, there's going to be all these hidden 007 emblems you can pick up. And those are going to give you bonus points. So that's sort of how you're intended to get 100% to unlock everything in the game. And this category is just play through the game while collecting all of those tokens.
So this is actually going to start on Paris Prelude, which is a bit of a tutorial level, and I'll give a count in when we're about to start. And it's going to be as soon as I hit restart on this mission, because it just starts instantly and it's easier to time. So I'll give you a count in a second. So 3, 2, 1, go. So right off the bat, I got to hit this tire shot really finicky. Oh, that works. I shot the gas tank. That works too. So I have to get this out of the way right away. Shoutouts to Shoulder Shot.
Yes.
So you just want to explain this, Matimbre and Fitter?
So actually this mission is divided into two portions. In the first section you have Metal Spoiler, where you have to shoot bad guys pretty much. And you try to save this red car in which there is Dominique, which is a French agent. And in the second part you have a driving section. And in this second part, this is where you're gonna try to beat up the first tokens in the game.
Matt Timber's house. It's a joke that that's his house. It's dumb.
Dumb French, you know.
Alright, so I gotta shoot this tire. Nice, got it. That's a bit of a tough shot there. We'll cut them off. So I'm gonna no-scope this like cable thing here, which allows the enemies to just fall off. And okay, good, got the shot. There's another shot you can hit here, which I didn't get. Auto aim kicked in. If you shoot the tire there, it just skips the, like, how do I say it, the like duration of when the car is going to the edge there, so it plays the cutscene instantly. So that was our first token of the run, and that's what we're going to be picking up primarily.
So actually this mission is supposed to be the tutorial of the game, but when you replay it, it's slightly different. You don't have this tutorial part and it's a bit less guided.
So I don't shoot rockets at the cars here, I just sort of... Oh, well that one blew up.
You want to avoid this.
But I'm trying to shoot the tires like I did there, because then that makes them get out of the way. When they blow up, they can just get in your way really annoyingly. So
Matimbre,
got the token.
How do you guys usually stop these getaway drivers in France?
just like you see here. We just have some cars that shoot missiles and rockets and cool gadgets. This is exactly how we drive in France and how we stop bad guys.
So, I definitely got that token. I know I did. So I got to use the brake there and stop that as soon as possible, because it actually stops with you stopping. All right, cool. So now we're going on to the exchange. The exchange is a pretty cool level. There's like multiple routes you can go. And let me introduce you all to the golden P2K, arguably one of the most broken weapons in this game. Right off the bat,
probably.
Just, yeah.
Yeah, like maybe video game history, honestly. I mean, it puts Halo Combat Evolved like to shame. It's just unreal.
So there's a weird quirk about this level that there's actually 8 tokens in this level, but the counter only goes up to 7 for some reason.
Yeah.
So in the end, you only have to actually collect 7 to get the bonus, but this is all tokens, so that's why I'm collecting all tokens. There's another trick you can do here where you can like jump across and push A, but there's a chance of softlogging, so I just don't do it. In marathons, at least.
Keep your marathon safe.
Yeah. Whoops. There we go. So, I mean...
Actually, since this is the first on-foot level, you're gonna see first little strategies that we use in this game. The first thing is that you may notice that Liam is strafing, which is kind of a known technique in across different games. So you move diagonally, basically, to increase your forward momentum. And we're gonna use something called clipping throughout the run. We're gonna use that a lot, and you will see that slightly later in this level.
Alright, so this is pretty funny if I get it, but... Yeah, I got it. It pushes the guy.
Awesome.
It's just stupid.
A little gimmick. Yeah, just with this game, it just like it shows, like you have a lot of like secret agent games, but do you know in any secret agent game where your secret agent can actually defy like physics and law of gravity? Probably not.
I got the line. I'd give that dive a 3, actually. Oh, I got the Bond puke hurt noise as well there. yeah, so those spotlights down there are kind of random. They can, they just have, like, random patterns in which they turn on. So this is the first clip of the run, which I messed up. Let's try that again. Nice, got it. Cool.
So basically this works by crouching and then crouching and pulling out a gadget at the same time. And by doing this, you basically change your hitbox, which allows you to squeeze yourself in between objects. And of course the game doesn't like that, so it pushes you out of bounds.
So now we're in the party, and even though we set off all the alarms, they just let us in anyway. And not even just let us in, they let us laser people. They're completely normal. It's funny though, because you can laser people. But apparently jumping is too like suspicious, so you notice when I try to jump, it just plays a buzzing sound. Very suspicious.
You can even punch the air. It's perfectly fine to punch the air. You can take pictures of people. No problem.
Alright, so we're going down to meet Dominique here because there's another token over here. And then we're gonna do another clip.
Yeah, we don't really care about Dominique, we just care about the token that she has.
Use whatever means necessary. Alright, so up here, we're gonna do our second clip. Nice. There we go. Oh, that fire is glitchy. Oh, it's not glitching, but sometimes it like shows a white box and it looks funny.
Most of the time when you're clipping in this game, you're gonna be going down through the floor because that's just how you're crouching through the floor. So that's just a. You're gonna get your head stuck in the ceiling and it pushes you down.
Yeah.
And you'll see a lot of those.
So this third section, I need to grab a rocket launcher and get away on a gondola. Right off the bat, I gotta shoot these two guys because they'll troll me at the door later if I'm unlucky. And these guys can spawn randomly, whether with pistols or SMGs. One SMG isn't really shooting me that much, so I think I can get away with that. That's cool. That saves about a second.
Yeah.
Oh, I got up boosted there. Yeah, so the way you get... The way, go on.
I was gonna say, like, you gotta love that, like, you have, like, the laser, you can, like, laser the people in the party, they don't get hurt, but you can use that laser to melt off, like, the hinges off of, that safe, like, you know, what's the logic behind that?
So, yeah, the way, like, fall damage works in this game is really dumb. Oh yeah, so I should explain what I did there first. I walked over this hole, and what that did is it activates the gondola, and then I grab rockets through the side, and yeah. Oh, I hope he doesn't shoot my rockets. I want to play it safe.
So Liam here is going to pre-fire for the helicopter, which is the first boss of this game. And the more you go through the game, the more you will notice that bosses in this game leave for very short time.
Yeah, usually can get that helicopter on the way over, but I had to play it safe because those guys can blow up your rockets if you're unlucky. So I wanted to make sure he was dead before I fired my rockets. Alpine Escape. Fitter,
Alpine.
Take it away, Fitter.
Yeah, so Alpine Escape is pretty much entirely an auto-scroller. Zoe is going to be driving us around in the snowmobile while we shoot bad guys. Liam's also going to be able to make some of the bad guys dance around here by aiming at their feet.
And he can draw too.
Yeah. You have some time to do whatever you want here.
So there is a bit of history. We probably have enough time for like, I don't know, 2-3 quick donations here, if you wanna go ahead with that.
Absolutely, there's a $5 donation from Bakuman SRE that says, I send lots of luck on your run, Liam. I'm happy and proud to see you there at SGDQ, and most important of all, be great and awesome on your run. It's your day. P.S. Scent has his own GDQ lamp percent category.
Thank you very much, Baku.
Thank you, Baku.
And there's a $25 donation here from Tay Smee that says, sup, Liam? Can't wait to see Deep Descent skip today. Wait, you are unveiling it, right? Shout out to Matimbre's HDTV.
Oh, that's good. I know who that is, dude. And there's a bit of a joke behind that, but yeah.
There's a couple of memes here.
So this here, there's... Well, Fitter, do you want to explain this this skip here?
Yeah, so it's possible to lure this snowmobile in just the right way to boost you through the cutscene, but it's extremely dangerous.
I don't do it because it can cause more harm than good, and that to save, like, what, 3 seconds?
So yeah, there's, right, like, a 90% chance something bad's going to happen, and then a tenth of 1% chance that something good will happen from it.
So I have to hit this guy through the cutscene. That saves half a second, and it also spawns this token.
Well, I was just going to mention about the time saves and auto scrollers. This mission is not totally on rails. Actually, there are ways to save time. It's all about killing enemies at just the right time. I mentioned earlier that Zoe is driving us around in a snowmobile, and she's going to slow down to give Liam time to kill all the enemies. So you want to kill them at just the right time, not too early, because then she'll slow down and never speed back up. But if you kill them at just the right time, she'll slow down for barely any time at all.
So I have to shoot these guys up here to spawn a token. I'm gonna play that safe and then blow up the gate.
Yeah, that one. That's annoying, that token there.
So for the longest time we suspected this level maxed was 402. And it was quite an interesting rivalry between Infinite Shoulder and Shoulder Shot. And then Ollie NK came along and got it randomly in a any percent run, just randomly. And then I got it. after I explain how this next funny thing happens, we have some time for more donations in a second. So this tree explodes for some reason. I don't know why, like, compared to this tree. Anyway, just a little quirk. We have time for more donations.
You got it. $20 from the crank machine that says, finding a pun-loving host is like a casino royale. The pun has to be a gem, too, because diamonds are forever. I shouldn't try my luck. I'd rather die another day, so I'll save my puns for later.
I love it.
Pretty good.
There's also a $250 donation here from Slaz. Thank you so much, saying, I've watched for quite a few years and managed to save up a decent amount over that past year, so I thought it was my time to do my bit. Thanks to everyone at GDQ for the years of entertainment.
All right, so this is a car level. We can... I had to let that line play. We have a smoke screen, non-lethal weapon. They say use it as a deterrent, and I accidentally said on stream detergent, so... It's kind of a joke now. Oh, almost missed that token. Almost.
That traffic was,
Was not nice. Yeah, the traffic can get in your way here, but, I almost missed that token. Got carried away with talking. Anyway.
So actually, when you play any person, there's a way to skip this entire level, but obviously you want to pick up the tokens here. So we don't do this, but usually most of the runs die in this level, in any person. It's a bit nicer in all tokens.
Yeah, cars get in your way, and it's not very nice. Get out of my way!
That's the problem for tokens.
Car NG.
Alright, cool. Gotta be careful not to shoot the police either, because if you hurt them, you fail.
Careful, 007. The local authorities mustn't be engaged.
So, again, I'm just trying to pop tires so they get out of the way. So there's a token coming up that I have to be really careful to get, because I can't back it up.
There's about 12 tokens in this game.
Okay, so here we go.
This is one of them.
Hang on. Got it, nice. Oh, gee, I always shake a little when I go for that token. Anyway. Yeah, we have some time for more donations, I guess.
Well, it's a good thing I have more donations, then. We have a $25 donation from Edward that says, another SGDQ, got most of the week off work so I can enjoy another summer of gaming speedruns. Let's get the Paper Mario bonus game met. And along the same line, we have $10 from Bon Shonery that says, one Paper Mario, chicken, not stern.
All right, so this ending, there's a token at the end here. I have to get those rockets. And I just gotta get rid of all these enemies. All right.
Normally in any person, you can skip right from the beginning to this section.
Oh, the game's lagging quite hard here. Okay, we're good. All right, cool.
So maybe now that wasn't easy vanquished?
Yeah. So we're moving on to Double Cross. Gotta remember these tokens. I always forget them in runs.
I'll remind you.
Exile Prince, you want to explain this?
Yeah, definitely. So Double Cross has to be like the most GoldenEye level that we have so far in this game. Although you don't really have to look down and like look up in the sky all that much. I talked about before that this game kind of just meshes a lot of like different subgenres of games in between. Like, was this when you have Mayhew here to escort him, make sure he doesn't get hurt? Got killed.
He moves. By the yeah, he moves faster when you look at him.
He does. But it's pretty much like, you know, look, he's not looking, he's right around the corner just like that. Come on, Mayhew. Hurry up, hustle. Anyways, Liam's gonna go for a strat over here with the stunners. The stunners help to incapacitate the Yakuza over here. As long as, like, they're incapacitated some way or another, either they're dead or they're,
I have to show stunned. This. They, like, dab when they're stunned.
either when they're stunned or, like, dead or something like that, then Mayhew can just come on by and just, you know...
By the way,
that's the end of that.
I don't know if you noticed as well, like, you saw how many Yakuzas I just took out with the golden P2K, like, exhibit A of how this gun is busted, you know?
Yeah.
I only need,
especially
like,
especially when you need auto aim.
So, like, the very next part, he's just gonna do some bond moves as well, like, I'm not sure if he's gonna show off his,
No, this is really dumb. Okay. You're supposed to shoot him from under the bridge, but it doesn't matter. So long as you're under the bridge as he's dying, you still get the bond move. Gong!
Get the gong. And anyway, so in this part, now you have to rescue some like the geisha girls that are being held hostage by the Yakuza. And, you know, as long as they don't die, then you should be fine. But if anyone gets shot, killed... then it's game over. This part really lags up a lot, unfortunately. And, gotta get shout out to the stormtrooper sniper.
Yeah, you're not supposed to be able to make that jump.
That could be a pretty hard trick to do. For Mayhew's computer, he has a lot of personal information that does not want to be breached out. You know, obviously, it's kind of like a difficult thing.
There we go. I was trying to shoot that fire hydrant because, you know, fire hydrants explode with fire.
Actually, in this level, you have to save hostages, and they can die very easily, even from the enemies. And sometimes this is a problem that makes us restart a lot this mission. If you don't have luck, as Exile said, they have pretty stormtrooper aim, so they may very easily kill a hostage, just like here.
Oh my gosh, I panicked. Wow, I panicked a little there. Nice.
This is the only part you'll do, like, clipping in this level. In any percent, there's no clipping at all.
That's because there's a token there. I almost fell down there. So I pick up the sniper. Uh-oh. There we go. Cool. So I pick up that sniper. That's going to come in handy later, and you'll see why. Got to be careful here that this hostage doesn't die. Oh, they're just blocking me. Okay, cool. We're good.
Gonna see like the hardest boss fight ever.
Well, actually it is harder, but this one is gonna be pretty hard.
Okay.
Watch.
So yeah, it's really difficult.
You guys don't blink. Don't blink.
Boom,
and boom, it's dead.
But this is not even the fastest boss in the game.
No, it's not.
Wait for the others.
So this is Night Shift. The guards here have some pretty funny lines. I wanna give a shout out. one of my best friends who I used to play Nightfire with as a kid, and we could never figure out that you could actually punch the guards, and it makes a funny sound. It's like bone crunching. That, and we have the upgraded stunner, which is a... It's just a literal sniper rifle, and you'll see it in a moment.
Stop right there!
Never gets old. So watch this.
It's just... It's unbelievable, really.
Yeah, they, like, dance too when you stun them. So if you're fast, you can get back before this guy spots you, which... Oh, I got the funny line, yes! Okay, so that was reverse clip. That's my host alert on my stream is that we've got an intruder! So reverse clip, do you want to explain how that worked? Matimbre?
I can explain it, it's fine. But the idea of reverse clip is just... It's sort of a weird one where you just... You do like a normal clip motion like you would normally do, but... Doing the same inputs again in reverse sort of pushes you through the elevator door more than you would normally. It's the only clip like that in the game, so it's
Well, at least I got the funny line again. Yeah, he can sometimes troll you with that door. So this is the vent clip here. It's I'm basically gonna crouch before the grapple hits, and it allows me to like run while standing up in the vent. So this is a keypad clip. I found this. Yeah. Oh, dude, it played the bass line after I got it.
I love that.
So do you want to explain that better?
Yeah. Well, in this level, it's kind of funny. There's actually three unique clips in a row. Like, we never do any of those again. But the keypad clip is just... You can still move for one frame after activating the keypad, and that includes moving through walls. So as long as you just keep activating the keypad and moving frame perfectly, you can get through there. It's not as hard to do as you would think.
Yeah, and it's really easy to mash too. I'll show you in a second once I get on this elevator. Yeah, so it's easy to just go like BA, 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 BA. Let's draw a nice smiley face. Kinda.
That's the nicest smiley face I've seen.
Yeah.
Alright, so there's a clip I was having trouble with earlier today. Let's hope I get this. I'm gonna try it one more time.
You got it.
Okay, I'm just gonna take the door. Yeah, that it doesn't save that much time, but still. I am gonna have to hit it later, though, which is not gonna be fun.
You know, there's definitely sometimes it just wants to just regular movement, man. I just gotta see that movement. I'm tired of seeing all these clips, man. I just... What are we doing with clipping? Like, is this even a real speeder anymore?
So, Oh, I didn't demonstrate it, but that like, mechanical sound, that was actually the door closing. I will also say we didn't keypad clip into that room because we can keypad clip in, we just don't know a way out that's faster.
Sorry for
so I'm gonna stun a bunch of these enemies.
There's a way that...
Looks like I didn't get any of them. Well, it doesn't matter because I've got the most broken gun in the world.
It gets me every time.
And use credit cards to buy hacks to fall through the floor. Alright, so we're coming up on Chain Reaction, which is one of the hardest levels in this run. Lots of intense clips, tricks. I have to be careful not to take too much damage. And let's see how we go.
Yeah, Exile Prince mentioned earlier that the snipers in this game kind of have Stormtrooper aim, but if for some reason they don't have Stormtrooper aim on the plane, they just annihilate you.
Oh, I'm on yellow health. That could be bad, but I think I'll be okay. Okay, so another clip there. It stops me having to open the top with the laser. Nice, got that clip. Cool. So grapple hook up here. So now we're going to use the Ronin to get a bit of height here. And we have to keep the Ronin though. So I'm going to do this. This is a bit of a tough trick. Oh, I didn't get it. I'll have to go for it again. Nice, got it. Cool. So, we're gonna need that later on, and you'll see why. So, this is the green door clip. It can be a bit finicky, but, let's try line this up. Oops. There we go, cool. So I'm technically inbounds right now. The game just hasn't loaded yet. There it goes. Get that token. Oops.
Yeah, so like,
It's hard to see where you stand. So you're not supposed to be able to make that jump there, but I just do anyway.
In this area, you're normally there would be like some guards that would spawn, but like because you loaded in from not crossing like that spawn point thing, whatever, then they just won't be there. Usually it would be riddled with a bunch of them, but because of we skipped it, so don't have to worry about them.
So this part's pretty intense here. I do have to focus here. I'm gonna go for a Ronin jump here. I'm supposed to move the crane to get to this originally, but nice, got it. I always panic a little when going for that jump, but anyway.
Timber.
There's another one to do.
Okay, so this here, gotta be careful not to fall.
So actually this is really risky, but you have to get this token up there, and then you can clip back into the ground to try to land back into your running and do this jump again to finish the mission. But this is really precise clipping and falling and jumping.
This is a frame perfect as well. There we go, nice. Got it, and then I have to do a leap of faith. No!
Oh no,
not this.
Oh no, so okay.
It can happen that this jump fails, in this case you have to die and start again. This is really annoying, but okay. Yeah, it happens sometimes.
That happens a lot to me.
Yeah, I know what to do now. I can do another clip that should be okay. Alright.
So this was kind of the risky route, but there's a way to do it a bit more safer. So.
But I wanted to like to see Matt Timber, do you know what was the deal with like this ladder that's like right here? What the heck?
I don't think sorry about that loud noise. I didn't oh, that is so loud. I didn't raise the Ronin back up. Okay.
So
I'm pretty sure I can.
What was the point of like having like that ladder like there? Do you think like the developer just got left there like?
So I'm gonna. Okay, cool. We're safe now.
Well, no, actually, you can. I think you can get on this ladder when you use the crane, so you have to move it.
So this is the safer clip. I went for the riskier one, but yeah, we're okay now.
But you can just use the run and just access directly this ladder. Pretty cool.
Okay, so we're gonna burn down that door with the laser. Whoops. There we are. Get that token. We've got one more token in this level.
And it's, actually, this laser is one of the few differences in terms of version between MTSC and PAL.
It's not worth the sunnies, but I'll do it anyway. Not the best chain reaction, but still.
You did the job. It's done. It's good. We're good.
So this is Phoenix Fire, another really intense level. There's gonna be a lot of clips, including a frame perfect. Security alert.
So if you play this level in any percent, this is one of the most intense levels, definitely. You have a lot of really intense clips that you have to do when you're getting shot from everywhere. In all tokens, there's also quite a lot of really complicated clips, and you'll see this. It's a pretty interesting level. It's also a really quick one. I think the developers intended you to do this level in 15 minutes when you do it in 30 seconds.
Okay, so that clip there is really, really scary. You can just fall out of the map. Well, I guess you are falling out of the map, but, like, fall down the entire building, which you don't want to do. So right off the bat, I have to shoot these two guys, but I've got to be careful because there's a hostage here. She gets shot, you fail.
She can get shot by the chopper here too and just fail for no reason.
Uh-oh. No! What? Oh, that was just instinctual too.
That's like, I think that was like better.
I don't know how you didn't die there.
That was
anyway,
crazy.
We'll just do it again. It's fine. Doesn't lose me that much time.
It's really easy to kill civilians in this game. They're really sensitive. Okay. Just a punch kill them.
Okay. They actually died there. Oh, what? That's supposed to blow up the window there. So we grab the rockets. And now we're getting some more tokens. Just some smooth movement here.
Actually, one of the hardest clips is coming up. It's going to be a frame perfect clip that saves about a minute and a half. Because otherwise you would have to sit through an elevator of the scroller. And yeah, we don't want to do this because this is speed run, obviously.
Yeah.
So yeah, this one is frame perfect and it's really tough.
We're gonna give William some time to like concentrate on this.
First try, easy.
Oh wow.
that made
up for like the.
That probably did make up for like that civilian death. To be honest, that is really really good.
Because this game runs at 50 FPS, so yeah.
Pal.
One frame is not that much.
So just gonna shoot some rockets for swag.
Lag up the game a bit, you know?
Yeah.
Give it a good old double seven GoldenEye feeling.
Alright, so that's pretty much the entire sort of like clipping block of the run, I guess. We do have one more level with it, but it's just... Yeah, it doesn't come for a while, so we've got a lot of, like, auto-scrollers and downtime. I'll just explain a couple things here, but we probably have time for one or two donations.
Look for an entry point and stay absolutely, clear of patrols. We have $10 from Canaria that says, best of luck, Liam. Lots of love, your British friends.
Canaria!
Hey.
Thank you
very much, Canaria.
And also $100 from Sinra that said, hey, Liam, awesome to see you running Nightfire at GDQ. You got this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You can still keep going if we have any more.
Yeah, one more.
Sure thing. $10 here from Liam's mom that says, it says, good luck, mate. All that gaming while avoiding homework. Now helping out a great cause.
I'm loving it.
Thanks, mom. All right. So you're normally supposed to use the remote torpedoes here, but you can use the regular ones. It's a bit of a tough shot. Okay, there we go. Good.
And the tokens in this mission are among the worst of the game, I would say, because they're really hidden.
Yeah, we have this term called troll tokens, and this level is just full of them. We're going to use a remote torpedo and another laser sensor in a bit, but we probably have time for some more donations. This is a pretty chill level, honestly.
No worries. There's a lot of love coming in for you on the donations. Derek Brosnan donated $10, saying, Liam, you're a legend. So glad I found your YouTube channel last year. I love the entire Nightfire community. I hope next year you run Bulletless.
Oh, my God. Yes. I don't think that's actually possible, but okay. Thank you. We got time for more.
We also have a $500 donation from Questlo with no comment. But Questlo, thank you very much for the generosity. And also another $5 donation from Taste Me saying, I just had to make another donation, basically because the announcer, me, I said Matimbre instead of Matimbre. So sorry about that. Thank you for the extra $5.
Thank you. All right, so here we have to follow this sub, and it's pretty simple. I'm just going to be cutting every corner, taking every shortcut I can, and eventually getting in front of the sub. People compare this part to, I don't know, the Phantom Menace, that one scene, but whatever. Oh, the other thing I should mention too is I do drive in first person. It just reduces lag and it's just less obtrusive than, well, that. Anyway, we have time for plenty of donations. Keep them coming.
Not a problem. There's another $5 here from Bakuman saying, don't give up, Liam. You're still great on your run. Lots of luck one more time.
Thank you, Bakuman.
Thank you, Bakuman.
And DW Russ contributes $50 to Doctors Without Borders, saying, we'll always donate for James Bond games. Thank you for the nostalgia trip, and thanks to everyone contributing to SGDQ.
Welcome to back.
All right, so a lot of people who played this game casually probably remember this level being the worst one because, like, there's no checkpoints in this level. If I was to fail right now, I'd go all the way back to the start. Obviously, we know where to go, where to drive, but the most notable thing is the sub at the end, but I'm going to show you all the best way to deal with it. So there's another troll token here that you'll all see. See if you can spot it in the cutscene. Did you see it? Now you did.
I saw it. Yep.
So, yeah, it's up around here. At least they kind of gave you a hint on this one. All right.
Yeah, we're a bit biased.
But we're upcoming on probably the worst token in this game. I hope you all are ready for this one. I hope you all are ready for this one.
We're at the very end, by the way. Of this level, at least.
Cube charge. There's no way as a kid that you found this one by yourself.
Beautiful.
By chance, just... yeah. Unless you just loved exploring like these linear levels.
The next token's a pretty bad one too. We'll talk about that one in a minute, right?
Oh yeah, when we get there we will.
So the strat over here is you put in the charges, like that submarine is literally a glass cannon. You shoot like the missiles, you hide behind that. Plant the charge and boom, that thing is dead. If that submarine were to shoot you, it'd probably be game over. Start back from the beginning, but because it's also, like I said, a glass cannon, it just like gets destroyed by your shots too. There you go. That's the strat.
Alright. So there's a troll token right at the start here. You ready for this one? All the way back over there, and it starts you out at full speed too, just to say, no, don't look back.
Keep going. Also, I'm not sure if people remember earlier while I was talking about car and G, it comes back. We got a bit. Yeah. We might have some car and G coming back in a bit.
It can be pretty bad in this level. All right. So we're going to enter the compound here. Pick up those rockets. Do a sick drift.
Tokyo drift.
Get the token. Shoutouts to the time I lost the race to you, Matimbre, when I forgot to download that code.
Just like you always lose your race to me.
So these cars can really not be very friendly to you. Okay, first one's good. The second one usually behaves pretty well.
Or
usually
not.
Behaves pretty well.
That was okay. That was good.
It was still okay. Will I flip the car? Let's find out. Oh, almost.
Yeah, like in this part, you like once you get through, you have to destroy those turrets. Those turrets can really shred like your health like really easily. But in order to progress through at least like this part, you just have to destroy like these place like turrets that are placed around. And it's linear. It's not hard to miss. Just if you miss it, then you have to just go all the way back.
All right. There's a funny sound here. Oh, I didn't get it. There's one where they go like, whoa, and it's funny.
There's a shortcut up ahead, but Liam doesn't really go for the shortcut over here. It's like nice swag strats, but...
There is another thing you can do where you can drive really fast and sort of bounce out of getting stuck in the bridge, but it's way too risky.
This part can be a little tricky. It's like the last turret they had to destroy.
Okay, hang on. So I have to shoot some rockets there, grab this token, and then get the armor, and that should get it. Cool.
There you go.
And we can shoot the plane too.
The plane you were gonna use, by the way.
Sorry, Lur, we can't make it to Drake's Island anymore. We destroyed our getaway.
Uh-oh. Yeah, one second. Liam's gotta restart his audio real quick.
Oh yeah.
Might actually tell you about a $300 donation we have here from Dave Say that says no comment. That's actually the comment. Also, a $25 donation from iSaltyBro saying, time for my favorite film series of all time. Sean and Pierce are 1 and 2. Good luck, and remember, as the great Sean Connery said, I like soccer. Especially when it's served at the correct temperature, 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit. Also, $25 from Brian J saying, another year, another SGDQ. Hey, virtual crowd, can I get a GDQ lamp for all the awesome staff and runners for putting on a great show for us? I think chat can help you out with those GDQ lamps. Is a $50 anonymous donation with no comment, but anonymous. Thank you so much for your generosity contributing to Doctors Without Borders. There's another anonymous donation here with $20. Come on. This one has a comment though. It says, great start of SGDQ. Thank you to everyone who's been working to make this event happen. Also $50 from Airwalk 251 that says, I love this time of year. SGDQ for the win. And Ace Cage also donates $50 saying, SGDQ 2021, let's go. And I love seeing those, the GDQ lamps. They are flooding chat right now. Lily the Lion contributes $250 to MSF saying, more games, more fun. Let's go Paper Mario. Let's go Paper Mario indeed. And Lily the Lion, thank you so much for that $250 donation. Now, to take a quick look here at the bid incentives to see just how much more we're gonna need for Paper Mario. Well, it's at about $16,500 out of $50,000. So we do still have some time to get that incentive met, but just because we like speedrunning does not mean that the incentive needs to be a frame perfect meet, right? We like free PBs, free gold splits just as much as anyone else. So we can go ahead and get that met well ahead of time, and that should be fine. We're taking a couple seconds here to get everything kind of reset for you. And I do want to remind you that we are going fast and raising money at Summer Games Done Quick 2021 online for Doctors Without Borders. It's an international medical humanitarian aid organization that works in more than 70 countries around the world, providing life-saving medical humanitarian care and speaking out about what they see in those areas. Their work aids people based solely on need, irrespective of race, religion, gender, or political affiliation. MSF relies mainly on the generosity of individual donors, with over 90% of MSF's income coming from private donors giving small amounts. And again, you may not know this, but a $5 donation to MSF is enough to purchase an MUAC band. The mid-upper arm circumference band is a simple yet effective diagnostic tool for assessing malnutrition. With $10, MSF can purchase 45 emergency food rations for use in a crisis or natural disaster. At $20, can purchase a suture set containing essential surgical instruments for emergency wound repair in the field. It's amazing the work that Doctors Without Borders is doing. It's also amazing to see the generosity that has been coming in from you towards MSF as we close in on $70,000. Speaking of that amazing generosity, Booperinos donates $10 and says, this is an actual comment. Smiley face. It is an actual comment and a great comment indeed. Thank you so much, Booperinos, for the $10. Well, BioFreak with $250 saying, awesome run so far. Keep it up. And we are going to get that Nightfire run back up and back going for you as soon as possible. It's been wild between the clipping and the sound effects and everything else. We got to see how that is going to finish. DocSalty96 contributes $25 to MSF, saying, keep up the good work, everyone. Absolutely, we will. And don't forget, there are some, well, there's also some incentives, but there are also some bid wars that you can keep an eye on in the near future. We've got the nickname choice for Nintendogs. I see a few names coming in there. Will there be a boop? Will there be a bop at some point as we get closer to the Nintendogs run? And if you are a fan of the doggos, we do have a Pet the Dogs incentive coming up in Zoda's Revenge Star Tropics 2. We like dogs. Do you like dogs? Do you like petting dogs? Well, Star Tropics 2 has some dogs for us to pet. But if we're going to do that, we got to raise about $3,700 more dollars before the Star Tropics 2 run. All right, and Liam is back. You broke Nightfire so much that it completely broke Nightfire. Let's see the rest of the game.
Three, two, one, go. Okay, sorry about that. This is now a complete auto-scroller. You just have to shoot that bridge really quickly.
I just want to remind everybody about how auto-scrollers work in this game. Once again, the girl driving the plane, Allura, is just driving at mostly a fixed speed, but there are ways to, you know, increase your speed a little bit, like this next guard tower up here. If you shoot it at the right time, you'll fly and save about 10 seconds versus shooting it too early. There's a couple of other scripted things, well, not scripted, but a couple of other things you can shoot and save time. All adds up to a grand total of about maybe half a second, so it's mostly an auto scroller. So pretty slow mission.
This is just a break before the big mission countdown that is coming right after this. Do you guys maybe want to have a little word about the story of this game?
Sure. Like pretty much like with Bond, Bond is tasked to like infiltrate a. Like a corporation that's held by Raphael Drake. Raphael Drake is like the main antagonist of this game. We'll probably see it like late towards the very end. We'll get there very soon. Pretty much is that he has like ownership of like, he hijacked like nuclear missiles that are like at a space station just outside of like Earth or something. Pretty much holding like the whole world hostage in a way just to have all the power in the world. So, you know, just, you know, if you can think of all like the typical like Bond, the premises for like any story or something. For this time, we take it out of this world. We just literally go to freaking space.
One thing I also want to mention about this mission is that it's not physically possible for a plane to fly this slow.
Yeah. It's Matimbre, you study physics. You want to explain how this works?
Well, actually, depending on the kind of plane you have, it might be possible, but with this plane, definitely not. But, you know, like, whatever happens in a video game must be true, right?
Yeah.
Of course. This game has defied a lot of, like, physics and almost anything just, like, natural that we probably would assume. You know, it's just the way how a lot of these, like, games are made. I kind of wanted to talk about, like, you could probably just see, like, how much, like rockets you have compared to, like your the D-1400, like holes with the gun. It's practically virtually impossible to, like, to go through, like, this whole level and deplete all of your machine gun ammunition. You can still, you can do it with the rockets, like, with no doubt. But with machine gun, they give you, like, a generous, like, way more than a generous amount to, like, to keep going. It was, like, the same thing with Alpine Escape, where literally have like plenty of like ammunition, machine gun.
Yeah, so I mean, this is complete auto scroll. There's nothing like this is just donation central, really. Here,
all right, gotcha covered. $20 from Maka Baka saying, awesome run, great performance, Liam. Much love.
Yo, cheers.
Also, there is a $50 donation from Super Turbo Pelican Puncher 9000 that says donating to support Liam. Technical issues stink, but the show must go on. Thank you to everyone who works tirelessly to run SGDQ. Also, Kabbalopolis contributes $15 to Doctors Without Borders and says an amazing start to the week, and I can't wait for all the other runs happening this GDQ. And don't forget, you can check on all of those runs by going to gamesdonequick.com. You can also check on the bid wars, the prizes, everything we've got going on this marathon at gamesdonequick.com.
Will I get it? I didn't get it. Yeah, if you shoot a rocket at the right time there, it just appears in the cutscene. It's really... it's just stupid, yeah.
Blow up.
So we're playing Titanfall James Bond edition now. Way to disable this contraption. So there's a really dumb strat I'm gonna go for here, just because, I don't know, it's funny. It wastes, like, it doesn't save any time, but I can pop the tires on this tank, because yes, tanks have tires.
Come on.
And if I line it up right. Got it. Nice.
Yes!
Yes!
That one's for you, Canaria.
Oh, man.
With that, it despawns like a second tank that's supposed to come by, right?
I'm so glad I hit that in this run.
Oh, man. That's amazing.
Makes up for the entire thing.
Yeah. All right, so
it's time to wake up because it's the end of this kind of boring level, and we're gonna go back to a level where there's a lot of clipping, a lot of strategies, and a lot of time cutting.
All right, so
Soviet submarine.
How did that not blow up? That is really weird. Anyway, so you can wake up now. We're actually playing the game again.
Here we go to the countdown.
So this last level is pretty heavy in terms of tricks, let's say. There's a really massive trick that we don't do more tokens towards the end, but there's still quite a lot of good strategies that will be used here. And I think you didn't see enough of bosses dying quite quickly. But yeah, this level has something to offer. So Liam is gonna pull out his mines, and he's gonna place three mines on the floor right there. And we will come back to this in a couple of minutes.
So yeah, you can like spam crouch here and you just move faster. Yeah, so once again, Golden P2K is just busted up. Really OP.
Actually, these corridors are really, really scary, especially if you play in the harder difficulty, because there's a lot of enemies and you have to go back from these. So you will meet a lot of people on the way, and they hurt a lot, especially since you're coming toward the end of the game, so they have stronger weapons and more health. So yeah, especially in harder difficulties, it's really tough.
So, I picked up those remote mines before. We're gonna use them later. So this trick I'm going to go for, it's called Slow Door Skip. Matimbre, you can explain this after I hit it.
Sure.
Oh,
that's it.
Man, that was close.
Go for it again. Oh. Okay, good, got it. There we go.
Nice. So basically you've seen this closed door. Normally you would have to wait 18 seconds for this door to open. But thankfully this game is cheese, so you can clip through walls and just keep the door and skip the waiting. So this saves about 20 seconds if done instantly. And right here you're about to witness a boss fight. So in the back on like here, Rook is about to spawn when the door opens in the back and he's dead.
Pretty one-sided fight.
Yeah. Well, another boss that leaves like not even a second.
Yeah, put those major air quotes for like boss fight.
Yes.
Yeah, boss fight. Yeah, so I'm gonna do a grenade shot right off the, like, right at the start of this part here. It's actually really easy to line up. as I miss it.
That's karma.
So, yeah, I hit a trip mine that, blows up and kills the enemies.
Those trip mines actually do, like, so much more damage than you make them in the book.
Yeah. So actually, Liam is in the silo, so the silo is kind of a maze, but as expected, you can skip this whole maze by clipping through a wall and skipping those doors. But in this category, you have to go fetch the tokens, and once you have them, you still go back and clip through the other door. In any percent, you can just skip this entire section and go straight to the end.
Alright, so...
are you about to do the clip now?
I'm gonna go for the armor here because I need help for later. And there's an easier clip you can do here, but I mean, I may as well go for it because it's closer. Cool.
Okay.
All right. So we're going into the final section of Countdown, where there's going to be like a whole section where the shuttles are launching. We usually skip it on any percent, but all tokens, there's tokens down there, so we need to go down there to get the tokens. All right.
Yeah, this is quite a bummer because this last trick is pretty easy to do and skips like 3 minutes of the game. But in all tokens, you have to go for it. You have to not do this trick because you want to pick up the tokens in this kind of scripted section at the end.
I find it kind of really interesting and funny that like you can literally like these soldiers will be like elite trained and stuff, but you can really throw a grenade and they just cower so badly.
There's something stupid I can hit here. I hope I get it. Oh, I might still get it. Good enough. Yeah, so Kiko walks in there and she just walks over the grenade. So if I get this, nice. That jump's a bit tricky to make. So you're supposed to go inside the bunkers. Oh no, I'm gonna die, the bunker's shutting. Oh no.
The missile, no.
The rockets are supposed to like head out of there.
It's supposed to instantly kill you, but it just doesn't.
It only kills you when you're standing on the ground.
There's another ninja, uh-oh. What are we gonna do?
Not even shoot a bullet.
You just gotta love how like they'll have like a boss fight in the middle of a game and then like in later in the game they'll deduce it to like just a harder mob.
So here's why I picked up the mines earlier. I can chuck them down here because I know where the enemies are gonna spawn. And then we can snap a cheeky pick.
What is that?
How does it feel to be beaten, James?
And then we can take out anger. For double crossing us.
This is gonna be you just have to wait here.
Yeah.
Alright. I don't know if we have time. I don't know if we have time for a donation if you guys can.
I think we do.
Yeah, sure.
Just one donation, guys.
Absolutely. Well, we have a $5 donation from a Sigzil that is just a suggestion. It says, we need a hotfix 007 event, James Dunn quit.
Oh.
I love that. This would be interesting, actually. James Bond games have pretty good speedrun. Well, you all know, I guess. There's many other good Bond games.
Age Under Fire, Everything and Nothing.
So yeah, in case you couldn't already tell, the kill trigger doesn't extend above these like things here. Oh, he didn't die. We didn't lose any time from that, though. I didn't put the mine down. We didn't lose any time there.
There you go.
All right, so that's Countdown. Yeah, that's sort of considered the true final level of the game, and because Equinox is now just completely scripted.
It provides you some action space, and there you go. And also some nuclear missiles, so there you go as well.
Secret Asian space. I like that with Drake, he talks about he leaves his hardened combat the veterans to deal with like with James like on here, but like once they pop in, like you can just aim at them like wherever the heck you can, and then boom, they're just instantly dead. See, boom, boom,
one shot.
Hardened combat veterans, guys.
All right, so this is a troll token here because it's in the way of the laser. I gotta be careful there. So, you can punch in space, so Okay, that's cool. But I can also do this. So it turns out to disarm nuclear missiles, you can just use your fists.
Oh, I love it.
This is where James Bond up to it. Why couldn't we do this?
Okay. Nice.
So oh, these are in combat vests.
They can actually do a lot of damage if you don't deal with them quickly.
There's basically two ways to save time in this level.
I got a little scared there because I thought I didn't disarm that missile. I was like,
I thought so too. Oh, yeah. I thought so too. I'm like, wait, what the heck?
So yeah, to save time in this mission, you can just kill the two first guy the faster possible. And killing Drake at the end so they can find boss. But you'll see that this one doesn't take too much time.
Alright, cool.
They're all just lining up for you.
They're just dancing in space.
They're literally freaking stormtroopers, like, no doubt. They got the lasers.
That's what I was after, this token. I was after that token. Did I get all... I don't have all the tokens. I think the last one's down here. I'll have to look for it.
You have time.
Okay, yeah, it's down there. Cool, okay. Alright, cool. That's all the tokens. Now we just gotta go for the last missiles. Those guys are still shooting at me. Where are they? There's one, two, three, four, five.
Elite soldiers, man.
Okay, good. I dealt with them all. So I have to fire as soon as Allura says laser, and it should just destroy Drake.
I'd like to mention that Drake is going to be up whenever his capsule...
Sorry, dude. Sorry, dude. All right, time's coming up.
When the capsule explodes, Drake is up, and when he shoots, he's down. So yeah, that's like a couple frames.
All right, time's coming up. Time.
Time.
Yeah.
Last Underestimate.
Thank you so much, everyone. I really appreciate it.
Good job.
I'm sorry there was tech issues. I did the best I could, but yeah, I had a good time. Thank you, everyone, for commentating. Thank you, GDQ, for putting this event on. Thank you so much. And anyway, that's Nightfire.
Guys, thank you so much, guys. Take care.
Shaken, not stirred.
The world is safe once again thanks to Callmeliam and that amazing run of 007 Nightfire all tokens. And with that, I'm going to grab a drink, stretch out a little bit, and we'll be back in just a moment. All right, friends, welcome back to Summer Games Done Quick 2021 online, brought to us by Doctors Without Borders. We're going fast and raising money for Doctors Without Borders. That is going to do it for me for today. We've got an amazing week of runs on the way, and then I will be back on Saturday to help out with Mario Kart 64 and Super Metroid. But in the meantime, as we get ready for the next incredible run, I'm going to turn it over to Asuka. 424 will be doing the hosting duties. Take care and have an amazing week.
All righty. Good morning, good afternoon, and or good evening, friends. And welcome back again to Summer Games Done Quick 2021 online, powered by Twitch. I'm Asuka424, and I'll be with you for the next few runs. But first, let's just chat about what the awesome sauce cause all of us are supporting this week. How's that sound? So, Doctors Without Borders, or MSF, is an international medical humanitarian aid organization that works in over 70 countries around the world, providing life-saving medical humanitarian care and speaking out about what they see in those areas. Their work aids people based solely on need, irrespective of race, religion, gender, or political affiliation. MSF relies mainly on the generosity of individual donors, with over 90% of MSF's income coming from private donors giving small amounts. For instance, for $100, MSF can obtain Ebola protective gear packed with everything their teams need to protect themselves on the front lines of the Ebola response, as they work to safely care for Ebola patients during an outbreak. So thinking about that, want to thank Craig, who donated $100 and said, "Games Done Quick is one of my favorite streams of the whole year. Seeing these games, many I remember playing as a kid, being broken is always so enjoyable. Keep up the good work, runners, the games, and runners of the event." Again, thank you so much, Craig. We also have Cheese Soda Punch donating $100 and saying, "What's better than GDQ? More GDQ! A donation goes to the first bonus game of the marathon, Paper Mario Incentive," which, well, we're doing pretty heckin' good. We are at $17,000. We are like almost, I can't even math, 40% there. So keep going. That is going to be an absolutely amazing run that you definitely want to see. All right. So with that, it is time to, well, stay cozy, everyone. Keep hydrating and enjoy this super quick, awesome interview with JHobz and MSF.
Welcome back, Summer Games Done Quick 2021 online. My name is JHobz, and I am joined by a very special person, is Kate Elder from MSF, to talk with us a little bit about her experiences. Kate, thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me. Hi, everybody.
So I first wanted to just give you a second to introduce yourself and talk a little bit about what you do for Doctors Without Borders.
My name is Kate Elder. I'm based here in Brooklyn, New York. I work as the Vaccines Policy Advisor for Médecins Sans Frontières Access Campaign. We're a small team, internationally based, that works on helping to improve access to medicine. So I work specifically on vaccines, trying to serve MSF's operations to make sure that we can provide vaccines to everybody who needs them.
Wow, that's fantastic. You said it's a small team. Was this something that was developed recently because of the ongoing pandemic, or is this something that branches into other areas of vaccines as well?
That's a great question, actually. The Access Campaign, this part of MSF, was founded about 20 years ago after MSF won the Nobel Peace Prize. With that funding, our movement realized that we needed a small team dedicated to improving access to the medical tools that MSF needs to treat our patients. Because it's not so easy to get vaccines or diagnostics or drugs. So 20 years ago, the Access Campaign was founded as a group of pharmacists, policy people, clinicians, communications, advocacy folks, to work specifically on the challenges of getting medicines for the people that we serve. So Usually we work on a variety of things. I usually work across all different vaccines, pneumonia vaccine, meningitis vaccine. But for the past year and a half, it's been exclusively COVID vaccine.
Yeah, I can imagine. But it's very lucky that, you know, you had that available already, that like this team was already put together for this kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. It was a team that was ready to pivot to the work that needed to happen to make sure that people are, you know, getting the diagnostics to know if they have COVID, getting the medical tools that are there. And right now, of course, I think everybody's pretty clear on the challenges of getting COVID vaccines to the developing world. So that's what we're, that's what I'm working on now all the time.
Yeah. So why don't you give me kind of an idea of what your day-to-day is like or what your role entails?
Oh, that's a great question. What does my day entail besides the mania of working, waking up and having it like drink from the fire hose from, you know, 8 a.m. through the night? The day is really varied, to be honest. So what we're doing at MSF right now to try and get vaccines to the people that have been really excluded. I know it's hard to think about it here because here in the United States, for example, we have pretty easy access to COVID-19 vaccines. But in the places where MSF is working, usually less than 1% of the population has been vaccinated, as opposed to here in the States where I think, you know, we're upwards of almost 50% of the population has been vaccinated. So wake up in the morning, check the insane email inbox and get to work, basically. A lot of the work entails working with other partners, other organizations to profile the need for governments to give vaccines to developing countries. So through donation of doses, like the United States government giving doses, the European Union giving doses. So one of our objectives is really just trying to get the doses that are readily available in wealthy countries to developing countries. Another part of our work is trying to help those developing countries to become more self-sufficient for future pandemics. So there's a big divide, if you will, between the people who get access to vaccines now because they're the countries that produce them. Like here in the United States, we have Pfizer, Moderna, et cetera. But in much of the developing world, that technology, that ability to make those medical products has really been, you know, held from them, from countries that want to do it themselves. So a lot of our work now is trying to push pharmaceutical corporations to share that technology and share that knowledge with the developing world so that they can be more self-sufficient. And in the future, they can combat these pandemics too. So whether it's through emails, calls, meetings, every day is a little bit something different.
Well, yeah, I think that's amazing, even just from sitting at, you know, in your office. And I think a lot of us learned this too over the last year and a half, what you can do just from home. It's cool hearing that you're talking to people in different countries all the time and really just working with trying to make this stuff available. I always like to ask if anybody has a particular story or a moment where you, like, MSF's impact really you know, showed itself to you? It's something that meant a lot to you about working with MSF?
That's a great question. There's so many moments where you start to just feel like, yes, like we can do something when we work together as a community and when we have the resources that such generous donors like Summer Games Done Quick has done to enable us to do that work. Something that comes to mind, a couple examples that come to mind. A few years ago, MSF launched a campaign targeting two pharmaceutical companies, Pfizer and GlaxoSmithKline, because they refused to sell us a vaccine that only they made, a pneumonia vaccine. And pneumonia is the leading cause of death for kids worldwide. And in the places where MSF works, I mean, up to 40, 50% of kids are getting pneumonia, and we can only treat it. But pneumonia can be prevented if you have a vaccine. So we really wanted Pfizer and GSK to sell us those vaccines at the lowest global price. So we launched a two-year campaign with a lot of advocacy, with a lot of support from the public, telling Pfizer and GSK, you got to sell this vaccine to kids in crisis. They finally reneged, and now we are able to vaccinate kids and protect them against pneumonia. So it's the little examples like that, which, you know, are very big for people living in developing countries, and that can only happen when we have, you know, the voice of the public. So of course the resources and the financial help is absolutely needed, but also your voice and your advocacy is needed to help us do those sorts of things. That's one example that comes to mind.
Yeah, I think that's great. That example in particular makes me think, you know, MSF is a large charity organization. It does lots of work in a lot of different areas all throughout the world, but hearing you talk about it in the way that you work with it, is it almost has this like grassroots feeling to it. Like you're always kind of trying to get these campaigns started. Does it feel that way to you at all? Am I misunderstanding?
That's the best way to categorize. That's the best way, I think, to describe it is, you know, change comes when people demand change. It's not from one organization doing anything. It's really a collective. It's a collective effort that happens through community. You know, I think about what's going to tip the people who have the power into really just doing the right thing. And I'm very convinced that it's doing the right thing to provide medical care to people who need it. But the thing that changes those decision makers is just hearing from their constituents, is hearing day in and day out from the number of people that this change needs to happen. So whether, you know, we're engaged in sort of civic issues here domestically in the United States, or whether we're trying to change things abroad for people who aren't as fortunate as we are, it's really, I think, very grassroots. And this is sort of the way MSF works too. I mean, that's how our organization was founded, right? There were some people that saw something that was unjust in a certain part of the world, and they brought that experience back and they talked about it. We have something at MSF that we call témoignage. It's a French word, of course, but it's really like advocacy. It's basically talking about what you see firsthand and using it to change things, make things better. And that can only be done by, you know, people using their voice and using their time and committing it to the right purposes. So it feels very grassroots to me too, Jeff. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and you mentioned community a lot there. That's always a big deal for us with Games Done Quick as well. And obviously, if people wanted to get involved, they can donate to Summer Games Done Quick. Go to gamesdonequick.com/donate, folks. But if they felt so inclined to get more involved, are there ways that you can think of that people can get involved with Doctors Without Borders more?
Please, please. You're already part of our community, and thank you so much for being such an important part of our community for the past 9-10 years that you've been around. And you can also absolutely join us through using your voice, through using your social media accounts, right? Change is happening right now virtually because many of us are still sitting in these holes that we've been sitting in for a while. But if you sign up for the Access Campaign newsletter, for example, at msfaccess.org, or of course through Doctors Without Borders USA website, you can tune in to the web broadcast that we put on that just share information of what we're doing. And then we can use your voice when we're next tweeting at Pfizer or Moderna and telling them to make their, you know, technology available to the developing world or to send their vaccines there. You know, your tweet is absolutely crucial too. So please sign up for our newsletters. That would be a great way to stay informed.
Yeah, that's cool. I didn't even know that the newsletter really existed outside of ones that get sent to donors and stuff. So I think that's great to hear about. Now, we're unfortunately starting to run out of time here, but I always like to have a little bit of fun, ask a little bit about maybe the gaming side of things too. Have you done much gaming in the past? Are you a gamer yourself, or is there a game that sparks a particular, you know, fond memory for you? Anything like that?
You know, I'm glad you're making me dig back in my memory archive, because it has been, I will admit, it has been a long time since I gamed. But when you say my gaming experience, I automatically think of my younger self with my handheld and do. So that is part of my childhood. So I'm not currently gaming so much, but I have lots of people in my life that do game quite a bit. Whether it's my brother or whether it's some friends that spend most of their nights gaming. Mm-hmm. It's in my life. But it's been a long time since I did it myself, although clearly it's part of my long-term memory.
Yeah, and I think Mario is like the perfect thing to have if you want to check out the speedrunning marathon, because we've always got a ton of Mario games, so that's always the perfect one to keep in mind.
Good, it's not too cliche.
No, I mean it like, again, that's like the most popular franchise for speedrunning. Super Mario Brothers 1 can be beaten under 5 minutes now. It's ridiculous. it's absurd. But yeah, I want to thank you so much for talking with me. You were saying earlier before we got started, Kate, that you were hoping to get a new like gamer name coming out of some like a new gamer tag. You can follow my easy, lazy way of doing it. My name is Jeff Hobson, so I just took those two, shoved them together, and I got JHobz. And so you could go with Kelder. I think that works pretty well. I think that sounds
I'll
pretty good.
I'll use that one. That wouldn't be the first time I've been called Kelder, so maybe I'll adopt that screen name. But I really want to thank, I want to thank you, Jeff, and I want to thank, you know, Summer Games Done Quick. Your community has been such a tremendous part of our ability to do our work in the places where MSF works, whether it's, you know, vaccinating a kid to prevent them from getting a disease, or whether it's providing medical care to people who are living in war situations. Your community, Summer Games Done Quick community, through every single individual donation you give, it goes directly to our field operations, so you help us to do our work. So thank you so much for everything that you do. We are infinitely appreciative.
Oh, and thank you again for your time and talking with us and sharing your experience with us, because I think that really, we have a lot of fun during this week and we get to play a lot of games and stuff, but I always love, this is my favorite part of the week, is getting to talk to people who work at Darkness Without Borders and really bring it all back to reality and what it's all about. So thank you again for joining me, and I'm going to send it back to our hosts so we can keep going with Summer Games Done Quick 2021 online. Bye, everybody.
Have a great week.
All right, welcome back to Summer Games Done Quick 2021 online. Let's get some awesome donations. First and foremost, we have a $50 donation from Shen, who just says, no comment, just a small helpful hand. And thank you for that helpful hand. That means so much to so many people out there. We also want to thank Sprout, who has donated $25 and says, SGDQ 2021 hype. Thanks for everything you all do. Both GDQs are always a highlight to my year. Let's break some records. I agree. That sounds like a really good idea. Don't you agree, chat? I did want to give a fantastic shout out to Melves, who has donated $5 and says, my daughter turns one in SGDQ all in the same week. It's gonna be a good week. Awesome. Thank you so much for your donation. Every little bit counts. And happy birthday to your daughter. All right. Right. So we have one quick more donation from a Captain Camacho, who has given $50 in donations and saying, long time watcher, long time donor. Go Team GDQ. And of course, greetings from Germany. But with that, sit tight and let's get ready for some massive hype with Silent Black Cat's showcase of K-Shoot Mania. Silent Black Cat, take it away.
All right.